Hi, I'm Gene Kelly, and I want you to come with me back to a time when where we went to the movies was as important as the movies we went to see. It all began here in the early days of the century, in arcades where we looked through tiny windows onto a special world. What we saw transported us to other worlds, pictures that moved, lived, and we traveled outward to the stars, or inward to all those hidden places where we keep our own dreams. What we saw was unbelievable, amazing, strange, and exciting. Take a look at where we went to the movies in those very early days. Narrow, small rooms called Nickelodeons, because that's what it costs to get in, a nickel. A screen at one end, a projection and ticket booth at the other end. Bare walls and very uncomfortable seats. Something like the movie theaters of today. But even nickels add up. By 1917, Charlie Chaplin was making $1 million a year. The movies were becoming big business. And so the builders and the architects, men with a dream, with vision, began to build larger and grander theaters that by 1920 would bring millions of people to the movies. And studio heads like William Fox and Marcus Lowe, who helped pay for the early picture palaces, built even more extravagant theaters, trying to outdo each other in magnificent excess. As the movies got bigger and more spectacular, the theaters rivaled them in size and imagination. In 1919, New York proudly revealed the 5,000-seat Capitol, and in the decade between 1920 and 1930, more than 250 major movie theaters opened their doors to a public that just couldn't get enough of the movies. Do you know what it used to cost to sit in a large, beautiful place like this for an afternoon or an evening just to watch movies? 65 cents. And for that 65 cents, you got not only the movie that you had waited weeks to see, you got music and live entertainment. From the moment we arrived to buy our tickets, it was a sense of something special, a feeling that it was an event, that once we stepped inside these picture palaces, we would be entering another world. A famous theater owner, Marcus Lowe, said, "We sell tickets to theaters, not movies." And when, finally, we entered the theater itself, we were already changed. We had left behind the everyday world, and we were ready for that special magic. The lights dimmed, and in many of those wonderful theaters, the mighty Wurlitzer organ began to rise out of the darkness. Gaylord Carter began playing the organ in theaters in the 1920s and has been entertaining audiences for over 60 years.
The great movie palaces of the old days were, it was like going into a cathedral. The Million Dollar Theater there at 3rd and Broadway was, it was like entering a great temple. But what was going on in there was pretty important too. Now, for instance, when I first went there in 1926, the feature picture was The Temptress with Greta Garbo. There was a 30-piece symphony orchestra in the pit playing the score of the picture and the overture. And then they would play the first 10 minutes of the last show at night, and I would finish the evening out with the rest of it. On the stage was Paul Whiteman with his marvelous jazz band, jazz orchestra, introducing the Rhapsody in Blue. There was a newsreel, a cartoon, and my organ solo was Roses of Picardy. I haven't played it since, and I don't know how I happened to play it then, but you got all of this for 35 cents if you got in before 6 p.m. The theater organ was developed so that when the organ came on and the orchestra went to take their rest, it didn't drop down and seem like you'd suddenly gone into a mortuary. What they did was increase the pressures in the pipes and give it a more vibrant sound. Then they added the traps and the percussions, tambourines and the bells and the xylophones and the drums to make it, to give it this orchestral effect. Now, I have this organ rigged up for that kind of thing, and here is some of the sound using these percussions and what we call the toy counter, which is the drums and tambourines and things. So that would be this.
¶¶
the music for the silent pictures had a very special kind of sound. For instance, a love scene sounded very, very much like this. Now, the name of that is Hearts and Flowers, and it was a famous, famous piece. In fact, it sort of identified itself with the early, early days of the silent movies. Now, the next important ingredient, and something that is in all movies, whether silent or sound, is the big chase. And that goes kind of like this. Now, I can go on like that indefinitely because some of these chases lasted 10 minutes. I remember one time, probably in about 1928, we were having a premiere of Tell It to the Marines with Lon Chaney. And the manager said, you're going to have to play for about an hour while the people are coming in. So he says, don't play the Marines hymn and marches and things furiously for that whole time. He said, I would appreciate it if you would just perfume the air with music. And I think that's a beautiful expression, and I've been trying to perfume the air ever since. But there are times when you have to get up and roar and make a big sound, and it's nice to have a balance between the perfume and the fury.
$5. Candle. How much? Oh, I think it. If you can cut to the front of the hutch, I'm not gonna get it.
Yeah.